everyone for joining us. Welcome to today's webinar, Your Guide to a Successful Business Analyst Career. I'd like to begin by acknowledging the land on which we reside. McMaster University recognizes and acknowledges that it is located on the traditional territories of the Mississauga and Haudenosaunee Nations and within the lands protected by the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Agreement. Please note that this webinar is being recorded. I would also like to inform you of the closed captioning feature. To activate it, please click on More at the bottom of your screen and then click Live Transcript. My name is Katie and I'm a program manager here at McMaster University Continuing Education, and I'll be your host today. We're very excited to have you join us so that we can discuss business analysis, our exciting new business analysis program, as well as related opportunities. Here on this slide, we have our agenda presented for our session today to give you an idea of the layout of the talk. So I'll now go ahead and introduce our speakers. We have Tendai Chakabuda joining us, Jonathan Nidak, and Leah Speltore. Welcome. We're very pleased to have you. Let me give you some more information about Tendai. Tendai will be one of our instructors here for the Business Analysis Program. She is also one of the subject matter experts who helped develop the program. Tendai is a certified business analysis professional with over 15 years of experience in the business analysis profession. She holds a master's degree in management information systems and is a certified scrum master, certified product owner as well. She is extremely passionate about business analysis and has a special interest in mentorship and development of young aspiring business analysts. Now on to Jonathan. Jonathan is also one of our instructors here for the business analysis program and was also one of the subject matter experts who assist us with the development of the program. He is a business technology leader with a diverse skill set in business analysis, project management, continuous improvement, as well as data management. Jonathan has been teaching these topics at Canadian post-secondary institutions for the last 10 years. He also holds an MBA, is a project management professional, and a certified business analysis professional. And now let's move on to Leah. We're so pleased to have you here today, Leah. Leah is a national account manager at IIBA representing all of Canada, Southwestern and Southeastern USA. In the span of her career, she's been dedicated to corporate and government enterprise and account management. Leah is focused on the growth of our Canadian and US business analysis community, business analysis practice, and ecosystems. No stranger to IIBA through previous roles, Leah spent several years as a team lead for one of our endorsed education providers. So now you have a flavor of our guest speakers for today, and I'll now hand things over for Tendai for her talk.
Great. Thank you so much, Katie, for the lovely introduction. As Katie said, my name is Tendai, and I'm an instructor with the newly launched business analysis course here at McMaster. Very excited to have everyone on the call. Welcome. I'm just going to really speak about how you can leverage your existing skills to become a business analyst. So before I go into that, I think I always like to contextualize what is business analysis. There's so many things out there. When I say I'm a business analyst, some people say I'm a finance person. Some people say I do numbers. Some people say, you know, it's something. So I really like to clarify what is business analysis. And I always like to use the analogy of a doctor, right? When you are unwell, when you're feeling sick, right, you go to a doctor for diagnosis, for treatment, right? And the doctor just doesn't just prescribe medication. They first need to understand what is causing your illness, right? And they do this using various techniques. They ask questions, they measure your temperature, your blood pressure, etc., right? So it's exactly the same with business analysts, right? So when organizations have business problems, they've got opportunities that they want to uncover or any needs, they approach us as business analysts to uncover and understand their business problems, right? So just like a doctor diagnoses a patient's health, right, we as business analysts, we really look at an organization's challenges, opportunities, needs, proposes strategies and any solutions, right? And we also use a variety of techniques and tools to do this. So anytime someone says business analysis, just remember my analogy of a doctor, right? So the keywords that you guys are seeing on screen really are four keywords that are summarized by the IIBA in their flagship book called the Business Analysis Book of Knowledge, right? There's a term called enabling change, right? So we are really catalysts for change, right? We really provide expertise and facilitate communication amongst our stakeholders, right? We define needs, right? And defining needs, really getting to a root cause of a problem, because we really want to gap the current state, bridge that gap between the current state and the future state. We recommend solutions, right? And of course, we deliver value really by thinking of innovative solutions that increase efficiency and productivity, right? Next slide, please. Thank you, Katie. So that is, in essence, what is business analysis. And I just really also wanted to present some really great statistics that should further motivate you guys to do the course with us and really delve yourself into this profession. Right. So business analysis is one of the fastest growing professions in the world. I think you guys are all aware that we are in the information world. There's so much information out there. Right. So some of the key factors that contribute to this growth is really there's an increased emphasis on data decision making. Right. Complexity of business operations. I think the past 3-4 years, right, you've seen with what happened with the pandemic, a lot of businesses really, things became complex, right, and business analysts, again, were called in to consult and help businesses solve business problems, right, the rise of the digital age, the digital transformation, which I think we are all seeing, right, also this whole customer-centric approach, which is something that's coming in. I think you guys are hearing customer success roles. There's so many roles that are following business analysis, as well as globalization, right, so those are really key factors that are contributing to this growth. Another interesting statistics, the IIBA predicts that between 2018 and 2028, an 85% increase in jobs, right? So this is something that you want to get on board, right? Because it's only growing bigger and bigger, right? And in addition to all of this, I think it's also a very rewarding career. Like Katie mentioned, I've been doing this for the past 15 years and I'm still doing it, and it's something that I enjoy, right? And 6 of the top 10 skills, by the World Economic Forum. So they predict the skills, right, in the next 5 years. And World Economic Forum said, you know, 6 of the skills, if you look at them, are just relating to business analysis alone, right? Guys, that's powerful, right? To know that the skill that you're doing is in demand in the future, right? Analytical thinking, complex problem solving, critical thinking and creativity, right? Those are some of the skills they mentioned, right? And 14,000 business analysis jobs posted on Indeed.com are expected to grow more than 30%, right? So these are really great, interesting statistics. And right now you guys must be a bit excited. You must be saying, Tendai, what does it take for me to start this career in this exciting profession, right? You know, some people land in the BA profession through exposure to projects, through application of specific skills. I myself started off in an operations role, right? Some people go through more of a formal structured route, right? Either way, you need to see how you can leverage your existing skill set, which is the next slide. Okay, so we're going to talk about what we call by transferable skills. If you can move to the next slide, please. Thank you, Katie. Right, we're going to look at transferable skills and how you can really leverage off your transferable skills. Back to the previous slide, right? So transferable skills are also known as portable skills or soft skills, right? Really, these are the abilities, the qualities that can be applied across various roles, various industries, right? They're really not tied to specific knowledge or area of expertise. They really focus on specific attributes, right, or qualities, or what do you call them? Yeah, areas of attributes that enable individuals to effectively navigate and succeed in your context, right? So transferable skills, really, they're highly valued by employers, right? Because they really show you as a person, as a business analyst, that you've got adaptability, you've got versatility, you've got potential for growth, right? So you might not have had the formal title of being a business analyst, but there are specific skills, right, that you could be applying in your current job, such as problem solving, such as analytical skills, right? All of these skills which are fundamental to grow your career as a business analyst, right? And some of the top 5 key transferable skills: problem solving, which I'll speak to, in the next slide, critical thinking, creativity, communication, stakeholder management, which we'll delve through as we go on to the next slide. Right. So on this slide, what you see is the 6 key category of competencies, right, for business analysts that was produced by the IIBA, again, in the BA book, which is their flagship book, right, for business analysts, right? As we go through each of these categories, really think about your own career and identify where you have applied these skills and how they can be carried over into business analysis role. You'll see I added a 7th one, which is emotional intelligence, which I'll speak to a bit later on, right? So the first category is really about analytical and problem-solving skills, right? So this is really required for business analysts to analyze business problems, right? And look for opportunities really to capitalize, right? And identify which changes may deliver the most value, right? You'll see their behavioral characteristics. What are these, right? So these, again, this is not unique to business analysis, but these are things that you probably have done in your past job that you can actually carry through, right, towards the business analysis professional. What do I mean by behavioral characteristics, right? Things such as trust, right? Such as personal accountability, delivering on when you're supposed to deliver, right? Adaptability, organization and time management, right? So these are key skills which we have really also incorporated in the material that you guys, hopefully when you sign up, right, will be going through, you'll be going through these specific key qualities, right? Moving on to the next one, which is business knowledge, right? Really, it's required for business analysts to perform effectively within their business, the industry, the organization, right? Business knowledge such as business acumen, industry knowledge, organization knowledge, solution knowledge, right? So these are all skills that are really grouped under the business knowledge competency. There's also tools and technology competency, right? As BAs, we use a lot of software application for support, for communication. If you guys Google any BA jobs, you'll see terms such as Jira, Confluence, Visio, right? And now with the advent of remote working, right? Some of the collaboration tools we're using, Miro, Mentimeter, Trello, Easy Retro, there's quite a lot that are really coming out there, right? So these are tools that we as BAs are using. Very important, if you have been using these, and I'm sure these are not specific, right, to being a business analyst, you should have been using this or should have in the last 3-4 years, right, with the pandemic. I'm sure you've come across these tools, and these tools, you can actually bring them over if you want to progress to be a business analyst, right? Communication skills, right? Absolutely fundamental as a transferable skill to bring across, right? Not only verbal, not only non-verbal, but a key thing for business analysts is a listening skill, understanding what your stakeholders are saying and really getting to the root cause of the business problem. And finally, interaction skills. Like I said, really as a BA, you're going to be facilitating a lot of meeting. You're going to be speaking to so many different diverse groups of stakeholders. So you want to be able to really bring across interaction skills. And I'm sure looking back at your career, if you look back at what you've done, you've probably gone through facilitating meetings, right? You've probably gone through leading some workshops, right? Those are the key things that you need to bring across and leverage off, right, in your specific career as a business analyst. And like I said, I've really added, oh, there's also interaction skills. Like I've said, I've added emotional intelligence, right? Emotional intelligence is really about understanding and managing emotions, right? It is not unique, again, to business analysis. I'm sure you guys have done this in your previous job or your current jobs, right? It's like having some sort of toolkit that helps you handle your feelings, right? Build strong relationships, make decisions, right? Like I said, the more people you interact with, business analysis, I always say, is a people job. You're speaking a lot to lots of different people. So you want to bring, you know, that whole emotional intelligence. So these 6 categories plus the 7th one, absolutely fundamental to look at, right, and really observe what kind of skills are each of these categories talking about and what skills can I bring across, right, to become a business analyst. And like I said, all of these skills have been incorporated in the material should you sign up for the McMaster BA course. Right, and then on to the next slide, right? Now that we've understood what business analysis is, right, I've then explained what transferable skills are, then I've spoken about the different key BA competencies at a high level. I could speak about this the whole day. I'm very passionate about this, but I'm really giving you guys, you know, just some bits and pieces, right? How do you go about bridging the gap? I'm sure you guys are thinking, Tendai, I want to get into this. How do I go about bridging the gap? The first thing, you guys need to enroll in the business analysis program to gain more insight into the profession, right? Like I said, the courses are really based on the latest BA book version. We've included a lot of practical examples and case studies. Katie will speak more in detail towards the end of the presentation about this, right? Join the IIBA network. We've got Leah on the call to speak more about this, right? IIBA, I've been a member for the past 10 years myself. It really has offered me a range of benefits and resources to really enhance my skills, my knowledge, as well as my career. So I'd encourage you to join the IIBA. Find yourself a mentor, right? I'm really a strong advocate for this point. A mentor really provides you the opportunity to discover, to grow, right? You've got someone who's been in the game, who knows the ins and outs, right? Who can relate to your experiences and give you sound advice. So it's very great. Find yourself a mentor who can give you accountability and the assurance that you can always reach out, right? When you've got any problems. And then finally, look for opportunities in your work environment to apply BA skills, right? Don't be afraid to put up your hand for project-related work, right? I think there's a saying that you will only know what you know. You have to push yourself further, right? So volunteer, get to do some other work, right? If you've got time outside work hours, another good avenue is to do pro bono work for nonprofit organizations, right? These are things that you can put onto your resume, even if you don't have the formal BA skills or the formal BA title, right? Use the opportunity to really go about and practice all of these skills, right? So I hope this mini presentation was exciting. I hope I got you guys stirred up. And I'm going to hand over to Jonathan to go ahead and talk about what the day of a BA looks like.
Thanks so much. Morning, everyone. Nice to have an opportunity to share some time with you here today. So we're going to talk, actually getting more than advertised. So we're going to talk about a week in the life of a BA. And my name is Jonathan Nituk. All right. So before we jump into the week in the life, just going to mention, not spending a lot of time on this, but this is a job characteristics model from some psychology scholars. And what these are factors that influence people's motivation in their work. And different job roles are, you know, stronger or weaker in different areas of these five things: skill variety, task identity, autonomy, feedback, and task significance. So hopefully you've looked at these and are thinking about, oh, that one's really important to me. Maybe this one is less important to me. You're looking for a role that's motivating and interesting to go to every day, right? So we'll jump into a week in the life. So it's Monday morning. You are a business analyst. On the next slide, please. And let's say on, oh, right. And these couple things of skills, I think Tendai did a great job mentioning those. So I'll just move on straight to our agenda for Monday. Okay, so it's Monday morning. You are a business analyst. And let's say we know that on Tuesday, you're going to have a big elicitation workshop. So elicitation is one of our key activities. It's how we draw out information from stakeholders, how we develop understanding of needs and all of those things. And let's say you're going to do that with a number of stakeholders on Tuesday, and you're going to use a workshop format to do that. So if that's what you're doing on Tuesday, on Monday, you are preparing for that. So you're going to review the goals. We don't have a workshop that says, you know, workshop about project X. That's not a workshop. You might have a workshop that says, you know, eliciting future state process for employee onboarding, if that's related to your project, right? It's going to be something very specific. So your workshop has goals. You're going to review those. You're going to review your stakeholder analysis. Who's coming to my workshop? What areas of the organization do they work in? What level of power do they have? Do we have people who report to each other who are attending this meeting? Are they from different areas of the organization and maybe in conflict with one another? How do they feel about the project? How do they feel about the solution that we're proposing? You know, all of those kind of things. That's your stakeholder analysis. You want to review that. You're going to review that and be prepared. You created a long time ago your agenda that says, these are the activities that I'm doing. These are how long they're going to take. This is when they start, when they finish, all of those kind of things. That's your kind of detailed plan for the day. You're going to review your techniques. Maybe tomorrow you're going to use affinity technique or something like that, affinity diagram. So you're going to review those techniques, make sure you understand how to do those, what the strengths and weaknesses of them are, what the challenges might be, and be prepared with your techniques. And then finally, the logistics, you own that experience for your stakeholders. So the room, the heating in the room, the lighting, the seating, there's food, making sure you have all the necessary supplies, you know, your technology, if you're doing remote, some of the tools that Tendai mentioned, like Menti and Miro and all of those things, like that you're ready with all of that stuff. So that's going to be Monday, is preparing for your big day on Tuesday. So now we're going to roll into Tuesday. And that is now the big workshop, right? So you are a facilitator for that workshop. You're going to start by opening that workshop. So you're going to talk about, this is why we're here today and what we hope to achieve today. Yes. And this is how what we're doing today is connected to the outcomes of our project. And this is how our project is connected to our overall strategy, right? Our executives have asked us to increase customer satisfaction. They've asked us to develop a new product. They've asked us to open a new market in a new area, right? This is how what we are doing today connects to those important strategies of the organization. You're going to establish the norms for that workshop. How is everybody going to behave? And then you're going to execute your workshop, right? So you have interventions you have to do. So if you see somebody not following those norms, you have to act on that. If you see somebody not participating, you need to figure out, what's this person's barrier? Why are they not active in this? You're going to manage the energy of your workshop, right? Have a variety of activities for people to do. Small group, big group, written, spoken, like different dynamics, right? Maintaining the energy of your group. You're going to get the information you need. Your stakeholders also deserve a good experience as they go through. You're going to track your progress and your outcomes against that nice agenda and plan that you had. You're going to close your meeting and restate, you know, this is what we achieved today and why it's important. You're going to go home and have a nice meal and have a good sleep after this one. And that's going to be your busy day for this week, maybe. Okay, so now you're on to Wednesday. So maybe Wednesday you're doing some modeling. So modeling is how we describe business solutions. And I think of this like a blueprint to a house. So if you look at a blueprint to a house, you can see this is what the home looks like from the front, from above, from the side. This is how the electrical is designed. This is how the HVAC is designed. We worry about different things. So we try to understand, what is the process that's part of the solution? What is the data? Who are the people involved? We might have prototypes and wireframes of what the screens are going to look like if it's an IT solution or a physical solution, right? What are the business rules that are in place? What are the non-functional things like availability and reliability that apply to this solution? So all of this is modeling work. This is analytical work for sure. And using some of those tools also that Tendai mentioned, like Visio, Lucidchart, whatever your modeling tool is, something that allows you to create these diagrams. The whole point of these is to create shared understanding so that your stakeholders understand what that solution is going to be. If you have an implementation team, they understand how to implement it, you know, all of those things. You're really trying to create shared understanding, and that's the role of these models and the modeling work that you do. So that's Wednesday. We'll go on to Thursday now. Oftentimes as a business analyst, you're working on more than one project. So maybe you have this other, you know, project number two, that's at a little bit different point in its life cycle, or actually some things have been built and you have an opportunity now to test them. So testing is a very detail oriented work. You probably did some planning beforehand on this to establish in testing, like, what are all the scenarios? I need to test the behavior under this scenario, under that scenario, under with this condition, under that condition. What if somebody does this? What if somebody does that? That's what your testing planning is about, figuring out what all those scenarios are, figuring out how the system should behave or solution should behave, and then checking to see if that's what actually occurs. And if it doesn't occur, maybe you have a bug or you have a defect and you have something that needs to be resolved. So you're going to track those results. So that's a very detailed analytical work might be on your Thursday. And let's say on Friday now, project number three is coming into your life. So you have a project that is maybe, you know, ramping up. It's starting up in a month or two. And you're going to do some planning around that project. So you might have an interview with the sponsor, right? To understand what's their high level objectives. What are they trying to achieve? You might be involved in a conversation of how this project is being approached. Is it going to be an agile approach? Is it going to be a waterfall approach? And then you're going to do a lot of analysis, right? About who are the stakeholders of this project? What kind of project is it? What does it involve? Is it tech heavy? It's more business process, a combination of them. Is it something else? Is it really involved with data? You know, analyze all of those things, and then you are going to develop your plan. So I'm talking about this on Friday because all of those things that happened Monday through Thursday, you planned all of them. You decided, what elicitation techniques am I going to use? What models am I going to create? Like, all of those decisions are decisions that you make. And so you might spend some time on Friday doing that. So that is our week in the life of a business analyst. And let's go to the next slide and look at these job characteristics. So I am being straight on this slide. I'm not going to say this is great, great, great in every element, right? Skill variety. I think the skill variety is tremendously high. So there are 50 techniques identified in the business analysis body of knowledge. You can see over the course of this week, all of the different things that you were involved with. So skill variety for me on a business analyst role is super high. Even talking about all the skills that Tendai mentioned, you can see a lot of diversity there. Task identity, you know, do you get to complete this in full by yourself? Absolutely not, right? So you are you're always working with others. You're always working with people. As Tendai said, you're part of a team. You're working with stakeholders, project managers, the project sponsor, all of these different individuals. So no, it's not like go and work in a corner and create your own little thing. You're working very much with others. Autonomy, I'm going to say, is very high. So as we saw in the planning, you're setting all of these things at the very high level, but even in the detailed level, that workshop, you designed the agenda. You decided what the order was going to be, how long things were going to take, what you were going to do, what you were not going to do, all of that stuff. You really have a lot of autonomy here. I need to take a moment for a drink here. So very high on that factor. Feedback, I think, is the flip side of that. That can be a little bit low sometimes. So it's very common to be, you're the only person on the project team with business analyst skills, right? So you don't always have that other person who's there saying, hey, you know, I got a piece of advice for you, or I have an observation. And the other thing that I'll mention here is your timelines. So this is a project, a lot of project oriented work. Sometimes you start a project and that project might not finish or be implemented for a couple of months, maybe 6 months, maybe a year, maybe 2 years sometimes. So you have to be comfortable with, be a person who's okay. Like, I'm working on something and the big, big result is not going to come for some time. And find ways to get your feedback through, you know, I had a great workshop today. That's going to lead to a great result later. But I don't see that finished product sometimes for quite some time. Last thing here is task significance. I'm going to say that's very high. You are involved with the strategy of the organization, implementing the strategic goals of the organization, getting everybody together to achieve those things. Some business analysts are involved with facilitating the conversations where those strategies are even set. So I'm going to say the significance is very high. I'll just say one last thing outside of this model is, you know, I have a lot of colleagues who once they get into a business analyst role, they don't really want to leave that, right? For all of these reasons, right? They're not finding a different role that offers the same things that this one does. And also, if you are interested in moving to other things, especially leadership, these are fantastic skills, right? That you're building, managing complexity, dealing with all of these things, really important for leadership roles as well. So that's it for me. Thanks so much. And I believe I am passing it on to Leah.
Thank you so much, Jonathan. Hi, everyone. I am here, as Katie had mentioned, National Account Manager with IIBA. I'm very privileged to have been afforded and given the opportunity to be here speaking with you all about IIBA. So who are we? How did this all come about? We are a not-for-profit global association built to serve business analysis professionals around the globe. So as the global thought leader for business analysis and the voice of the business analysis community, we actively support the recognition of our profession and work to maintain global standards for the ongoing development of our programs and certifications. We advance business analysis communities really by connecting and supporting all types of industry. We have corporate, we have academia, which you're going to be attending with McMaster, as well as chapter communities and organizations that these types of practitioners work for. You'll find your peers, friends, and a wealth of other opportunity there. 120 chapters is something that IIBA has, and chapters are in 40 different countries at this point in time, where you can actually build those peer connections aside from even your academia. So as we'll see moving forward, what is it that we are looking to build and to achieve? So when I say we are committed to shaping the practice of business analysis to achieve better business outcomes, we brought together the global community of business analysis. And for those who are not familiar in IIBA's history, it really began in a bank in Ontario with everyone saying, we got to really build this thing and formalize it. So what we did is we moved forward and formalized it in the body of knowledge, which you're going to hear BABOK over and over again, or BABOK, whatever you want to say, however you want to, which will provide the standards, resources, certifications that gives professionals really the confidence they're going to need to do business analysis the right way. If we can move forward into the next slide, Katie. the Guide to Business Analysis, the Book of Knowledge, is the globally recognized standard for the practice of business analysis. And it describes business analysis knowledge areas, tasks, perspectives unique to underlying competencies, techniques, and perspectives on how business analysis is approached and executed. The primary purpose is really to define the profession of business analysis. And as we're going to see in upcoming slides, there also the business analysis core concept model, which is included in the BABOK guide, really do help in discussing and defining those skills that are really necessary for business analysis. Multiple languages. I do want to also mention that the BABOK guide is offered in, I believe, about eight languages at this point in time. So English, Chinese, standard French, French Canadian, German, Japanese, Russian, and Brazilian, Portuguese. I'm holding off for the Italian version. I'm hoping it's going to be here soon. It's probably in the works, so something to look forward to. Next slide, please, my dear. So what are the benefits of business analysis? Practitioners work across all levels of an organization, and they may be involved in everything from defining strategies to creating an enterprise architecture to taking a leadership role. As Jonathan had mentioned, if you're looking at leadership roles, really pertinent there. And business analysis practitioners have specialized knowledge that act as a guide and lead the business through unknown and unmapped type of territory to ultimately that desired destination. What does that mean? It's the foundation for understanding what your customers will want. It is ensuring that projects, programs, your portfolios actually achieve what they're intended to. We're creating better business outcomes. Better quality decision-making is just a million different things that are added to that. As we move ahead, spoke wheel on our next slide, Katie. We see that business analysis is really involved in everything from defining strategy to creating enterprise architecture, which I just touched on before. When we're looking at business analysis, there's an analogy that I use quite often, and it really has to do with identifying what is the core root cause. So if you have, for example, agriculture, you have a farmer, right? They've suffered from a poor crop yield in that particular year. Well, it could be due to the land being arid, poor quality of seeds, the weather's not holding up the way that it should. Unless the root cause of a problem is really identified, there really can't be a viable solution. So that's where business analysis comes in. And as we're going along and as we progress and as we engage with our communities, we're also seeing that the prescriptive term of business analyst, that title is no longer necessarily the only title. In everything that we do, we touch on business analysis. Next slide, my dear. So why is it important to be certified? What is it that we're finding engages business analysts? We do research on a regular basis. We have identified that business analysis is really in the upcoming years going to be one of the core job roles that are being considered and looked at. And certification has a number of benefits that it will offer. You will have that higher confidence once you leave your education and be in the workplace, or if the work that you're currently doing now, it'll just give you a higher confidence. It helps with upskilling. Organizations want to see certified personnel to know that they're approaching business analysis in the right way. Percentages for salary increases, greater fulfillment at work. It can even help in finding that job role that you're really striving for. From recent research, so if we can skip ahead to the value of business analysis certification. From research, the Global State of Business Analysis, the survey identified that 45% of certified business analysis professionals reported a higher rating of career satisfaction. Through that greater confidence and performance, they were able to also find that it brought them greater fulfillment that I'd mentioned before, and it also assists in helping professionals find jobs. BA professionals who hold more than one IIBA certification are actually looking at earning about 12% higher than a non-certified individual. Competency-based certification. So as I just mentioned about BA professionals, one certification is sufficient, but even more than that is just showing that you're doing things the right way. And many business analysts also have project management experience and certifications that they're looking at. The ECBA certification, which is the foundation, actually is available in multiple resources in those languages that we've mentioned for the Babok. ECBA resources in that regard as well. I'd like to take some time to look into IIBA certifications. We, at this point in time, and we are growing with our research and evolution, currently have seven IIBA certifications, three of which are the core to our business analysis foundational work. ECBA, covering that foundational knowledge on how to approach business analysis according to the prescription of the Babok guide. Also very important to note that the Babok guide itself is not prescriptive. So it can be interpreted and utilized in different ways as well. The certification and capability in business analysis recognizes skilled business analysis professionals who have had anywhere from 2 to 3 years of practical business analysis work experience. And as we move forward into what we would call our higher elevated certification, the certified business analysis professional recognizes seasoned business analysis professionals who have over 5 years of practical business analysis work experience. So everything that you're doing within the learning that you're going to be having in your courses with McMaster and our business analysis curriculum will all work towards IIBA certifications. You have that reported measure of professional development. So I highly, highly suggest looking into this type of certification that you'd want to get into. There's also, now we're going to move forward into some other slides, specialized certifications, which we are offering. The AAC, so the Agile Analysis Certification, strengthens your skills and expertise. It focuses on applying an agile perspective within a business analysis framework. As well, the certification in business data analytics, which is the most recent, one of the most recent certifications, it came to fruition through research that we had done in data analytics. And it does recognize your ability to execute effectively when we talk about data analysis related work in support of business data analytics initiatives. As well, two more specialized certifications, IIBA and IEEE Computer Society worked and partnered together to offer a robust learning and certification program on cyber analysis certification. And our most recent, Product Ownership Analysis, another great certification that we're offering, which will recognize the integration of business analysis and product ownership with an agile mindset to maximize that value. That's really, you know, what I wanted to have a conversation with you all about today, to talk about IIBA, who we are, the benefit of membership you're open to above and beyond the schooling that you're going to be having through McMaster and the data analytics program. You also have Knowledge Hub, which is direct access to analysis, access to those discounted certification and membership rates that can be provided to you as well. So I thank you very much for having me here, and I will pass it over to Katie.
Thanks so much. Thank you to all of our speakers today, Tendai, Jonathan, and Leah. I really enjoyed listening to your presentations. So now we're going to jump over and have a quick chat about our very exciting new business analysis program that we have built with our subject matter experts. So here as an overview, the program at MCE, the courses are offered in a convenient online format. Each course is 4 weeks in duration, and we offer 8 courses. The titles of those courses, we can show you on the next slide. So to earn a certificate of completion, which is very exciting, we've put in a format of a microcredential, learners would just need to complete 3 of the 8 courses in order to do so. So what will you learn in the business analysis program? You'll learn to expand your business, systems thinking, and organizational knowledge within the business analyst strategic process. You'll learn to identify, analyze, verify, validate, and define the requirements for business analysis improvement solutions and how to monitor and evaluate business analysis. So we're very proud to be a partner with IIBA, an academic program partner, and 5 of our courses, band 100 through band 105, have all been endorsed, and the rest are to follow. Moving on to this slide here, you can see the titles of the specific courses that we offer for band 100 through band 107, as well as for programming planning purposes, the dates that each of the courses are offered. We plan to have multiple starting points for the program. There's 2 points of entry in the fall of 2023 term. And if you'd like to get started rather in the winter 2024 term, you'll have the opportunity to do that in January as well. And starting in the winter term, we're starting up the other higher number courses, which are the band 103 to 107. I did want to point out that we do recommend for folks without a business analysis background who are new to the profession to start out with the band 100, 101, and 102 courses in order to provide that foundational knowledge for the subsequent higher number courses. And of course, all of this information in terms of dates is posted on our website. The course descriptions are all there for you too if you want to learn a bit more about, for example, what a strategy analysis course entails. If you want to learn a little bit more about the assessments, we have course outlines on our website as well. And that gives you information of what you can expect about the type of assessments, a little bit more detail about what to expect in the course. So I'd encourage you to have a look at those as well. And as a reminder, we have some really great information on our website. This is the business analysis page that you can navigate to through our homepage. We really encourage you to have a look there. Any questions at all, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. We'd be happy to help.
Thanks so much, everyone, for joining us today. I know also we all enjoyed kind of sharing our thoughts here. And thanks again to all of the other speakers. Have a great afternoon, everyone, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you all. It was great meeting with you.